Good evening and welcome to Centering on Peace. My name is Blair Seitz, your host for this evening. Centering on Peace is brought to you on the second Tuesday of every month by the Berks Peace Community. The program is sponsored by Wells Fargo Foundation and the Berks Peace Community. The Berks Peace Community meets at Reading Friends Meeting on each first Monday of the month. Sometimes we are sponsoring special programs, and we have a potluck before the program. Our last program was featuring a gentleman from the West Bank of Israel in the occupied territories, and he told us about what it was like to live in Palestine. Our meetings and events are always free and open to the public. The discussion tonight is about climate change, and I'm really happy to have two guests with us, John Ankele and Richard Whiteford. John Ankele is co-sponsor or co-director, producer of the movie The Wisdom to Survive: Climate Change, Capitalism, and Community. We will be viewing parts of this remarkable movie during our show. John is a New York-based filmmaker who has produced 25 movies. Previous movie to the film that we'll see tonight, or parts of the film, was Buddha and Jesus Practicing Across Traditions. John is an ordained Presbyterian minister who is also a student of Zen and the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. Welcome, John.
Thank you, Blair.
And Richard Whiteford is a writer and environmental activist from Downingtown. We have so many qualified people who live so close to us. It's really wonderful. In the 1990s, Richard worked for the National Sahara Club as a Northeastern conservation organizer. He now represents the Climate Reality Project and the Citizens Climate Lobby. He has made nearly 300 presentations to universities, high schools, religious institutions, and civic organizations about climate change. So welcome, Richard and John.
Thank you.
Our viewers are welcome to call in to the program. You can call in on 610-378-0426. We're going to see two segments of the movie, Wisdom to Survive. The first we will show you now, and then John and Richard will comment on aspects of that section of the movie. And then when we start our second half hour, we will see a second segment of the movie. So let's roll the movie now.
The thing that's at the heart of our daily lives is the abundance of cheap fossil fuel. For 200 years, it's defined what it means to be a Western human being. Everything we do all day relies on fossil fuel. It's what's made us rich. The problem is that same fossil fuel is now killing us. And so somehow we have to get off of the thing that's at the center of our daily lives before it does us in. That's a very, very difficult task, the most difficult task that human beings have ever faced.
I think that climate change, let's say 20 years ago when we understood that it was due to our burning fossil fuels and as well as our deforestation of forests, was an unfortunate consequence of our industrialization. At that time, there was no need for judgment because people didn't realize that that could actually change the atmosphere, which in turn could change the radiative balance on the whole planet. But now we know it is no longer just a consequence of the Industrial Revolution. It is a crime against humanity. And we need to articulate and come up with a language for that crime.
For most people, the discussion about climate change is kind of abstract. You know, we're talking about how many parts per million of CO2 or how many degrees warming by what date. But really, this hits people in the form of vulnerability to natural disasters, floods and fires and droughts.
That's been happening in places like Australia. It's happening in the Sahel in Africa. It's happening in regions where people are making a living by dint of extraordinary labor and effort, just barely. And then this tiny, tiny change in the expected amount of water comes, and oh well, it wipes you out. And that's what they're facing. And when you get wiped out, now you've got to move, you've got to leave, but nobody wants you. You have these displaced populations of people who, as their desperation increases, do exactly what you and I would do if our desperation increased enough, which is they become, in their efforts to find food, in some cases violent. And so that increase of violence is a direct effect of global warming. It has been recognized by the U.S. military as the great future problem, which the United States security forces will be facing. Displaced hordes of people. One of the things that oceans create for the world is glaciers, of course, because the evaporation of water from the oceans goes up and falls as rain or snow, and in high mountains collects as ice and becomes glaciers, which then, as pure, unsalted water, flow down to the sea. And as global warming occurs, of course, these glaciers are all melting. They're going away very fast. Now you're talking about a couple of human lifetimes. There are whole cities, to name a random example, Los Angeles, which are utterly dependent on glaciers. There's a lot of people out there who say once the problem is sufficiently severe, science will find a way. And the answer to that is baloney. Science will find a way which, if you can afford it, might work, sure. But let's put it this way. Suppose Los Angeles ran out of water. Solve that one. And the answer could be, oh yeah, well, you put in a desalination plant, a giant desalination plant. Yes, but what happens to the price of water at that point? And how much will you enjoy paying, you know, $1 a gallon for water just to wash your car or water your lawn? Science will not solve the problem, but any sort of reasonable expense level to pay for things, which are the services that are performed free by the environment. Somebody has actually put a price on that, has guessed at what it is. If I recall it correctly, I think it's the free services performed by the environment for humankind worldwide come to $30 trillion a year. Well, that's no problem. I mean, we'll just raise the $30 trillion and perform those services for ourselves. No. When CO2, carbon dioxide, dissolves in seawater, it turns into carbonic acid, and that increases the acidification or the acidity of the oceans. And that's going on big time because, of course, there's so much more carbon dioxide than there was before. And what that increase in acidity does is an absolutely dreadful occurrence. You can show experimentally that that's going to result in the inability of a huge number of species to actually lay down shells. They won't be able to do it anymore. And the result is they'll die. And if those species are plankton, these little single-cell things that nobody ever worries about, but which are the absolute foundation of life on Earth, if that happens to them, that's it. These planktonic creatures are the base of every oceanic food chain, and all these oceanic food chains result in the species that we eat most and rely on most. Over a billion people in this world have as their principal source of animal protein. If plankton go, nothing makes it out alive. And I fear that's exactly what's happening. I also fear that you can just kiss goodbye to the beauty of coral reefs. I don't think that's something that our great-grandchildren will see or know, except in films. And is that important? Oh, yes, it's very important. These coral reefs are structures which are, of course, support whole island nations. If you remove the protection that the island has from massive ocean waves, then the result of that is the island goes away also. If you lose coral reef completely, you lose all the species which depend on coral reefs, and there are a huge number of them. Most of them are extremely beautiful, so you'll lose a lot of beauty.
This problem would be hard enough were it confined to one nation, ours, because the power of the fossil fuel industry is enough to make it very difficult to get change to happen here. It's made infinitely more complex by the fact that it's the first global scale problem, and we need to involve the entire globe, and much of that globe, most of it, is poor. Our deep economic inequality, which has always been a sin, is now an enormous practical impediment to getting action, because China, India, and the rest, the easiest path for them to pull people out of poverty is to do it the way we did it, burn lots and lots of cheap coal. If they do that, there's no hope of dealing with the global warming crisis. It'll just overwhelm us. We have to figure out some way to allow China and India and the rest to forego that coal burning and develop anyway. And that's going to take some serious help from the rich world in the form of technology and resources to allow that leapfrogging to happen. We'll find out if we're generous enough to do that or not. It's all a question of pace, whether we can make the politics change as fast as the physics and chemistry are changing. I'm always well aware that the world around us is not going to be any more beautiful or intact than it is right now, so I do everything I can to take great pleasure in it. One of our jobs is clearly to bear witness to the beautiful world that we were given and to understand that it's never going to be quite this glorious again, so we better pay attention. And I do.
Dear darkening ground, you've endured so patiently the walls we built. Perhaps you'll give the cities one more hour, and the churches and cloisters too, and maybe those that labor, you'll let their work still grip them for another 5 hours or seven before you become forest again and water and wilderness. In that hour of inconceivable terror where you take back your name from all things. Oh, just give me a little more time. I just want a little more time because I'm gonna love the things. I'm gonna love the things as no one has thought to love them.
John, every time I see this movie, I'm just amazed at the effort and persistence that you had to make it, to put it together. Like, what motivated you?
Yeah. You know, it was an interesting thing. My colleague, Anne McSuit, co-producer, she had been at an event with Bill McKibben, who's the leader of 350.org, and kind of the on the vanguard for many years, for the last 20 years, really. Mm-hmm. Of the climate change movement. He was on the staff of The New Yorker, and at that time he wrote a series of articles that ended up in a book called The End of Nature. But he and many others who were prescient saw this problem coming. And Anne met him, and he gave her a book, his latest book called Earth, and she read it, and she was quite inspired by it and also alarmed. And so she gave me the book, and I read it. And we were just shocked with the sense of urgency that was coming through Bill McKibben's understanding of this issue, because he's done research for 20 years on it and really is the scholar, and in terms of the science and the economics and everything, is able to understand it.
I hear alarm and urgency.
Indeed. And, you know, it came through in the barest details. For example, reading in that book, based on research that he had done, that soon after President Obama was elected, there were 2,340 climate change lobbyists hired to work in Washington to, you know, appeal to Congress on behalf of their the corporations they were representing, because most of these 2,340 lobbyists were employed by the fossil fuel industry. And just to imagine that they were positioning themselves because they anticipated that President Obama would work us out of fossil fuels and more toward alternative energies of solar, wind, geothermal, and so forth. And this was going to hurt their bottom line. Mm-hmm. So here's this massive army of lobbyists descending on Washington in January 2009, when President Obama was inaugurated.
That says a lot. Here we are 7 years later. Richard, we saw in the movie the glaciers, the drama of the glaciers melting. Like, what are the facts now of the glacier, of the sea, of the carbon in the air?
First of all, I went to Glacier National Park 2 summers ago, and 11 of the glaciers were totally gone, non-existent. And the Grinnell Glacier, which has always been the crown jewel glacier in the park, was, it looked like a small napkin laying on a rock way up on the mountaintop. We're losing glaciers globally, all over the world. The land-based glaciers put they raise sea level as as the water melts from the glaciers. It raises sea level, and you know it's. I think one of the most startling things of all is that for the last 3 or 4 summers, the polar ice cap has melted down to only about 25% of the polar ice cap is left. And that's really bad because that causes what they call a feedback loop, which means that the more open, dark water there is, the more sunlight it absorbs. And the more sunlight it absorbs, the more it warms up the ocean, which melts more ice and on in a cycle. So we've lost, you know, the polar ice cap, which I think should be a serious alarm for anybody. I'm not sure how people can deny climate change after that. On the other side of the world, in Antarctica, this summer, the Thwaites Glacier broke off. It's a huge glacier, broke off, and it's moving at a glacial pace, but it's committed to go into the ocean and melt. And scientists believe, the scientists are at NOAA, they believe that probably 30 to 40 years from now, sea level will be 4 feet higher than it is now.
You said NOAA.
Yes.
Can you tell us what NOAA?
Yeah, it's a mouthful. The National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration. They are the scientific
sounds
body.
Pretty official.
They are the horse's mouth, so to speak, in the scientific
community. So we really have two things going on, interrelated. One is the melting of the ice.
Mm-hmm.
And the other is the buildup of carbon in the air, which traps heat.
Yeah. We're pumping 90 million tons of CO2 in the atmosphere. And when I say we, this is a global. This is global. 90 million tons every 24 hours. And that stays up there for at least a century. It doesn't dissipate. And so, you know, it's sort of like pumping up a beach ball or something. Every 24 hours you pump 90 million tons in there and it just keeps going like this. It's getting hotter. The more heat in the atmosphere, the more moisture content that it keeps up there. Some of that moisture is wicked out of the soil in certain parts of the earth, which causes droughts. That's why Western United States is in drought. That moisture gets redistributed somewhere else and it comes down in monster storms. And it can be snow. You know, when it snows, you get a big snowstorm. People call me up and say, where's global warming now? Well, there it is. It's the moisture.
Last winter.
Yeah. and so it creates, you know, it has caused a imbalance in the distribution of moisture around the planet. And the other thing that has happened, too, is as the Arctic has heated up, it has really caused the jet stream to go wacky. And we're seeing, that's why the Northeast got the winter we got last year, because it was all that, there was no vortex there to hold the cold in the Arctic. And so it came, you know, it escaped and came down here and got us. So,
but still I hear people saying, go ahead, John.
No, I was just going to add the element of some of that carbon dioxide does end up in the ocean, And the marine biologist that worked with us on this project, Roger Payne, talked about then the acidification within the ocean. It turns to carbonic acid, which kills the coral reefs.
And shellfish, too.
And the shellfish. Mm-hmm. And
this
when
was
they
a
die.
New revelation to me in a movie. I had never seen that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I've snorkeled on coral reefs. I've seen the tropical fish, and it hurts me.
Yeah, if you've gone the last few years, as my wife and I, we love to go snorkeling in the Caribbean.
When were we in Africa?
Yeah.
30 years ago.
Yeah, well, we did it there, and the coral reefs were very alive and very colorful.
Right.
But now when you go to the Caribbean, they are a kind of amber color, and that color is missing, and there are far fewer fish. I mean, many, many far fewer fish in the coral reefs.
John, you bring up a really good, important issue here, too, is for millions of years, the Earth had a symbiotic balance between carbon, and like you said, the oceans would absorb some of it, trees, you know, vegetation would absorb some of it, and there was always this balance, this equilibrium. But since about 1850, when we started burning fossil fuels for the Industrial Revolution, that's when we created the imbalance, because we put more up there than what nature did on its own, and we threw it out of balance. For 800,000 years to a million years, the CO2 levels were on average around 280 parts per million. Mm-hmm. In the last, since 1850 and on, we have increased that to 400 parts per million. That's where we are today. That's out of balance with nature. Mm-hmm. And the ocean can't absorb that much. The trees can't absorb that much. And what we have happening here is another feedback loop where wildfires and the timber harvesting going on in South America and so forth are cutting a lot of vegetation out of the system, so there's no vegetation there to absorb the additional CO2 that we're putting up there. So we just keep compounding the situation.
And in addition to that, Roger Payne, we learned from him that there's about a billion people in the world who depend on the fisheries that are associated with coral reefs and in these coastal areas. And so as these fish die, you know, they lose their source of food. And amazingly, yesterday, Secretary of Defense Hagel got together with 30 defense ministers from around the world to present this Pentagon report that talks about the threat to national security, I mean, worldwide security, because of people who are losing their food source, that 1 billion, depending on the fisheries, and all the other people. You mentioned the droughts who will be displaced, the climate refugees, that one estimate that we came in contact with in our research was that there'll be 700 million climate refugees, perhaps even by the middle of this century.
Mm-hmm. Let me remind our viewers it's something that we tend to forget about is that some of you may have just come on the air. Let me say that we are the program centering on peace, and this evening we're talking about climate change, and we have our guests here, John Ankele, movie maker, and also Richard Whiteford, who is quite an expert on climate change. And you can call in to us at 610-378-0426. Richard, what you're saying is very convincing, okay? But yet, there are lots of people who do not buy this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, weather forecasters, for example, might be very conscious of how weather has changed over a long period of time. We have these cold times, we have the wet times, we've had floods all the time. We used to have floods in the Mississippi. And so, you know, this might be just another cycle we're going through. What do you say to them?
Well, first of all, the weather events that we have now are much more frequent, much more severe than any time. I this weather is not my grandfather's weather at all. It's very, very different. In fact, today there were 17 tornadoes in the south, and there's another hurricane developing out off the east coast. But the I'm sorry, I blanked on your question again, but we have
what
the science.
What do you say to unbelievers?
We have the science. Most of the deniers, there are a couple different types of deniers. One are the people who are paid for by the fossil industry. Mm-hmm. All right, there's the Heartland Institute that receives a lot of money, millions of dollars of money from the oil companies to say that climate change isn't true. And they actually put out a publication on Earth Day last year, and I got a copy of it. And you go through it, and there's no science in it at all. It's opinion. When I give my speeches, you know, I'll get a denier in the audience, and I'll say, bring your science up here. Show me your science. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this for 8 years, and nobody's brought me a postum sticky with something on it. There is no science. Yeah. 97% of all the scientists on the planet that are climatologists are convinced that humans are causing climate change, and the evidence is there. When you lose 75% of the Arctic ice cap, you know, I mean, it doesn't, what else could you, you know, if you can't accept that as a evidence for climate change, I'm not sure what you could, you know, accept.
And then, you know,
let me finish.
Sure.
The other kind of denier I find are people who are seeking attention. Mm-hmm. They're not scientists. They have no background in climatology at all, but they take a contrary point of view just because that's what gets them in the news and gets them attention. Some of them get paid to be contrarians and so forth. So that's the other type.
Wow. One thing that makes me sad is that, as we saw in the first segment of the movie, a lot of the already severe climate events are happening in poor countries to poor people. Mm-hmm. What is the morality of this? I mean, we created this. Mm-hmm. We meaning the affluent, mostly the affluent West, although we're all acknowledging that China and India are very much a part of this now. So we're sort of high and dry, mm-hmm. for the most part, mm-hmm. although we did have New York.
For
and,
now.
Yeah, for now. Now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How do you, what, John, you're a theologian, mm-hmm. what do you say about the morality, mm-hmm.
I think
theology,
what,
or
yeah, what I would say is based in, you know, our this new world really since the Reagan years, since 1985, when the global economy, in part because of policies that came out of our government in Washington, began to weave together, you know, so that the. It's no longer just our national economy, it's a global economy, and we have a vested interest in that, and we helped construct that economy through structural adjustment programs and other poverty initiatives in which we were trying to get poor countries to shift to private economies, mm-hmm. away from public services, you know, and so that has happened. We are the architects of that policy. Now, do we have a responsibility to the people in the poorer countries who are suffering because some of those policies have not borne fruit or have worked actually against the interests of those people? Right. And climate change is not unrelated to that, because it's corporate efforts often in poor countries that keep them poor. You know, when our corporations go into a country because they can pay low wages, or because there are cheap resources, or because there are lax environmental regulations, then don't we have a moral responsibility to those countries when the people become impoverished?
Another thing I'd like to point out,
sure.
too, is right here in our own country, as it relates morally, there are still victims from Katrina that have never been taken care of. Mm-hmm. They've lost their property, they're still homeless and so forth. And you know, a lot of those people were low-income people. In New Jersey and New York, there are a lot of wealthy people that have lost their homes and so forth from Hurricane Sandy that haven't been settled with either. Mm-hmm. And in Louisiana, around the coast, and parts of Texas on the coastline, southern coastline, mm-hmm. there are people who are still suffering economically from the destruction that the oil spill caused down there. Mm-hmm. And the people are not getting any restitution for this. That's a moral obligation mm-hmm. from a corporation that ruins your life.
Mm-hmm. We'll be back. First, let's look at the second segment of the movie. And then we will talk again. This is the program centering on peace, and my guests are John Ankele and Richard Whiteford. You may call in 610-378-0426. Let's roll the second segment of the movie.
It's not like, oh, wow, now we recognize there's a problem. We don't know what to do about it. We do know what to do about it. We need to transform our energy system. We ought to be creating 500,000 jobs a month in this country now. There are these huge technological innovations that could be pursued, but it helps to have a real price on carbon to do that.
Moving from fossil fuels to wind, solar power, geothermal, micro hydro, tidal power, wave power, there are many options, and most of them are very good, especially in certain places. But we're not going to be able to replace fossil fuel energy on a one-to-one basis rapidly and make money doing so, so we will be making sacrifices in the process.
My excitement about these 21st century technologies that may arrive is that in June, July, August, we have more sun by 9 o'clock in the morning than we could use all day. There's so much energy hitting the earth from the sun that in 1 hour, the photons of light energy can fuel the world's economy for a year. For a year. 1 hour of sunlight. So there is an abundance in the world that we have not understood. But it's my faith, actually, that climate change will bring us to this new kind of understanding, new infrastructure, new experimentation that will really change civilization. And that this is the trigger, this is the catalyst for that transition to occur.
I'm not such a good soul that if I thought this had no chance of succeeding, I'd waste my time flailing around at it. I think we have a chance. I think the game is not yet over and the outcome not yet clear. But I sure don't think it's going to happen automatically. I think the only hope is to build big movement.
A true citizens movement that is big, that is tough, and is determined to make deep change. If there's a model in living memory that we need to try to, you know, find again, it was the civil rights movement. People understood that they had a deep grievance, and they understood that the system they were working in was illegitimate, and they set out to demonstrate that.
We are going to act. You know, power responds to a demand, and we have to let that demand be heard, and it's time to step outside the system and do some things that we haven't done before.
We got to be careful as we do civil disobedience. We shouldn't make young people the cannon fodder for it. I think it should be those of us who've spent our lives burning fossil fuel. We need to make very clear who the radicals in this scenario are. They're not people demanding an end to fossil fuel burning. The radicals are the people who are willing to fill the atmosphere with twice as much carbon as there used to be and just see what happens.
There is movement building around the world, and what you're seeing is that the movements are connecting. So the environmental movement is connecting to the sustainable food justice movement. The food justice movement is connecting to the women's movement. The women's movement is connecting to the LGBTQ movement. So we just simply cannot look at these problems in silos.
What needs to be done is connect these groups, which are prefiguring in their work the future world. After all these years of being deprived of meaning in our lives, we have an opportunity to fight for something real. And it's not just a fight, it's really a much more joyful existence to live in reality.
This climate crisis, it could be some of the
worst sorts of things we will have seen here on the planet as the disasters pile up and there's more of them, you know, than we can deal with. So the question is there about hope. Is hope necessary? What is hope in this context? And I think my answer would be hope is this equilibrium, this steady mind, the willingness to be present for what it actually is, and a curiosity, a kind of, well, what will it really be?
When you're in the middle of a big adventure, you don't have time to decide whether you're hopeful or hopeless. That question can bring you out of the present moment. It can throw you into imaginings and conjectures when all your energy should be right here in the moment.
I don't think there's any hopeful outcome from this where we avoid all messiness. You know, somehow the tooth fairy is going to come down at the last minute and make everything okay. It's not going to happen. We're headed into a very, very difficult time. It's going to be an extraordinarily painful transition for our species and for the rest of the natural world. That said, how painful it is and how many of us survive and how much of nature survives, all of that depends upon what we do now. So can you imagine having the opportunity of being alive at this moment in history when so much is at stake and choosing to go to sleep instead?
If you want an adventure, boy, what a time to choose to be alive, to get a chance to find out what you have inside you in terms of vitality and alertness and courage, what you have to discover in terms of what we can do together. Don't waste time in self-pity over darkness. Don't waste time trying to figure out better circumstances that you might like. You're born into this, and you're here to love it and to see that it goes on.
I cannot turn my eyes. I cannot count the cost of all that has been broken, all that has been lost, and the light.
Today are John Ankele and Richard Whiteford. Thanks a lot for being here, and thanks for watching Centering on Peace. You know, the climate change issue really came home to me, and I went into a different paradigm, I think. And John, quite frankly, your movie gave me a more positive look. September last year, 2013, National Geographic ran a story that if we insist on burning all of our fossil fuels, coal, oil, that in 5,000 years from now, all of our coastal cities will be totally underwater, and most of Earth will be uninhabitable, too hot. It will be an era of no ice. 5,000 years may seem like a long time, but in the space of Mother Earth, it's a very short time. Mm-hmm. And to think, for me to think, that our very prosperous industrial era, a time of great luxuries in some ways for all of us, that this has brought us, could result in that. It just, I didn't know what to do with that. So what do we do with that? Mind you, I did use a big if there, and National Geographic uses an if. But given the power of the fossil fuel industry and the extent we are going to now to extract all of the fossil fuels, it looks like we're going in the wrong direction. Can you help me?
Well, I think Bill McKibben is instrumental in starting a movement that I think is going to continue building. I think there was some footage in the movie where 2 years ago in February we went to the White House and there were 40,000 of us. It was very cold outside that day, and we had a big fake pipe, oil pipe, and we surrounded the White House with it. That was the beginning of that movement. Now, a couple weeks ago, we had 400,000 people in New York City to tell the UN that we want to have this taken care of. We want something to be done with this. Mm-hmm. This movement is not over yet. Mm-hmm. That's what I do for a living. And our lives are at stake. Human survival is at stake. We have got to do this. And so far, money has talked, but it's only gotten away with it this long because there hasn't been a big enough, strong enough movement to change that. And we have an election coming up. They can spend all the money they want, but if everybody gets out and they vote, and they vote some of these people out of office, it won't matter how much money they spend. They'll be out. They'll be gone. Mm-hmm. We need to get people to get off the couch. You're invested in this. Especially if you have children. If you have children, you have grandchildren. You owe it to them to get the bull by the horns and do something.
Mm-hmm. Vote. What else? I mean, people have to have practical things to do.
Well, one of the big things, I mean, we've done the Curlicue light bulbs. You know, we have Priuses, and, you know, I've gotten lucky enough to drive a Tesla. You know, I'll never afford one. But the big issue, the thing that needs to happen, and the Citizens Climate Lobby, along with Jim Hansen, is driving this. Dr. Hansen, from formerly president of NASA, is to have a carbon tax and a dividend. And even some Republicans now, because you know they are real knee-jerk about taxes, but they're hearing this and they're starting to like this idea. And the idea is to tax carbon at its source, at the coal mine, at the wellhead, and then you give a dividend from that money. The government gets not a cent of that money. You give a dividend to every tax-paying citizen in the United States, and that dividend will help offset the increase that's going to happen with fossil fuels because it's going to make them more expensive. The second thing you do is you stop giving the fossil industry $90 billion a year in tax subsidies. And you take that money and you put that money into investments for clean energy. Those are two things that could get us on a fast track right now if we can get that. And there are people in Congress trying to get a bill, get some legs under some legislation to make that happen. Those are two can-do things that we need to do as soon as possible.
John, do you have something to add?
Well, on the philosophical side of the practical, you know, the practical is always informed by a change of heart if it's to be lasting. And early on in our film, we weren't able to see that tonight, but there's a cellist at the beginning who, Eugene Friesen, who went out with the marine biologist Roger Payne to record the sounds of humpback whales. And he brought those whales' sounds back into the studio and played in concert with the whales, his cello, back and forth. And we ask him, you know, what he thought was being communicated by those whales singing to each other. And he said, I don't know what they're saying. He said, but all I can think of is, he quoted a line from Dostoevsky. He said, beauty will save the world. Beauty will save the world. And when you think about it, and your own experience, our own experience as a beauty in the natural world, there's something about it that opens us and relates us to the natural world, free of our own desires and wants and needs, you know, our own ego concerns for pleasure and comfort and that kind of thing. And happiness in that moment is redefined. happiness is no longer about my own consumption and pleasure and comfort, but happiness is rather about the quality of my relationship with this larger reality.
So part of our history in Western Christianity and Western culture is that we have seen ourselves as being separate mm-hmm. from nature. Exactly. I think I hear you saying that. Yeah. The Native Americans that you have in other parts of your movie saw things differently. Mm-hmm. They had an ongoing relationship with Mother Earth. If I may just throw in, mm-hmm. I had an aha moment when I'm a photographer, when I was photographing leaves at not so far from here, the sun coming through the leaves. And you see the veins and the capillaries in the leaf. Mm-hmm. And I said, aha. I have the same creator that you have. Mm-hmm. We are made of the same stuff. Mm-hmm. We are family, because that looked just like the pictures in the doctor's office mm-hmm. of our own
oh, yeah.
arteries and capillaries mm-hmm. and all that. It looked very similar to what we see in plants and flowers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the problem. We yeah. have drained nature of its spirit. You know, nature has become a commodity. Mm. We've materialized it so that it's seen as a resource that then has economic value, or greater or lesser, depending on, you know, what we need to use it for, a kind of utilitarian materialistic view. Mm-hmm. And we failed to remember that the spirit that animates nature is the same spirit that animates us, mm-hmm. you know, and that nature is full of spirit. Nature is spirit in the sense of energetic, wakeful quality, you know, that's alive mm-hmm. and can call us into being through mm-hmm. our relationship with it, and to a sense of wonder and mystery that resides there in that relationship, when we're able to open ourselves and respond to it.
So John, what do you say to folk who say that this is in God's hand, mm-hmm. that we, why should we mess with reality of what's going on here mm-hmm. when God is the ultimate provider, the ultimate mm-hmm. say in this? Mm-hmm. How do you answer that?
That betrays an older kind of antiquated view of God outside creation, you know, and taking mind and spirit with him as he sits out there and kind mm-hmm. of looks down and enters in when he wants to adjust something or reprimand somebody or reward somebody else. You know, that notion of God outside nature is really not biblical. The Hebrew notion is that God is very much a part of creation. Mm-hmm. That God dwells through his spirit, you know, within human community and mm-hmm. within nature. Mm-hmm. So it's failing to recognize that you know, we are the manifestation of God through our being in the world, and that what we do ultimately matters just because of that.
Richard, the second word in the movie, in the subtitle, climate change, capitalism, community. Is this an attack on capitalism?
Wow, I have to take pause to think about that. I would say yes and no. I think that yes, because I think the heart of capitalism is that it's unsustainable. It demands more. I mean, just take the housing market, and in this area in particular, we just took out all the farmland, places to grow our food and so forth, and put houses on it. And we built so many houses that we got to a point where we had a collapse in the market. But when you hear the financial reports, they still bring up housing starts as one of the main
indicators.
Stays of capitalism, and it's unsustainable. I think what we have to do, and the no part of this is that we have to develop some other system that we can operate from that's not capitalism. And I don't know what that is. I've been discussing that with a couple professors that seem to be on a track to figure that out, but I don't have the answer. That's not my area. But the way capitalism is at the moment, it is absolutely the biggest cause of climate change. It's all about the money, and it's there's no consideration for spirit or life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there's an interesting article in September Harper's by Joseph Stiglitz, who is an economist who's worked for the World Bank, I believe, and in on development issues and addressing poverty. And his point is that this is not what we're practicing, real capitalism. This is ersatz capitalism. He calls it, you know, a kind of fake expression of capitalism, because corporations have managed to create monopolies, you know, and so there isn't real market competition in the way that creates innovation and drives down profits naturally, and allows for more people to participate in the creation of wealth. So, you know, it's tricky business, because we get into an ideological area and everything. But what we do know is, I agree with Richard, that we need to re-examine the system in light of human values. And instead of defining democracy as freedom to get as much money as you can get, you know, at the expense of the environment and other people, to look at it rather in terms of fairness, you know, which we've always known and we know in our hearts. Freedom from hunger, freedom from disease, freedom from indignity, freedom from discrimination. These are the important qualities that we know are right, you know, and it goes back to your earlier question about morality and people in the rest of the world. You know, aren't we all entitled to those freedoms that have to do with fairness and not just self-aggrandizement through grabbing as much as you can get?
Richard, a chance to say some last words.
My advice is leave carbon in the ground or humans won't be around.
Leave carbon in the ground.
Leave carbon in the ground or humans won't be around.
Richard had that sign down in Washington during the climate march.
I think that's original.
In front of him, Fox News. And
But that's as basic as you can get. We have got to stop pumping CO2 in the atmosphere. We're in for a rough ride right now. And, you know, when I started 8 years ago, CO2 levels were around 370 parts per million, and you weren't really seeing climate change, you know, the effects of climate change yet. But in the last 4 years, 5 years, it's been rock and roll out there weather-wise, with droughts, floods, wildfires, tornadoes, hurricanes, and so forth, to a much more extent than it used to be in past decades.
So we have some practical things that we can do, all of us. That is less gasoline, more walking, less users light bulbs. But then we have the huge political challenge before us that you all have brought out very well.
Do I have time to?
I have something
I use in my talks a lot of times. Mm-hmm. I live on a hillside outside of Downingtown, and our development has 700 houses in it. And when you burn 1 gallon of gasoline, it puts 20 pounds of CO2 in the atmosphere. That stays up there for 100 years.
Wow.
You know, 20 pounds, that doesn't sound like very much when you're talking about 90 million tons, you know, every 24 hours. But on a Saturday morning, if every one of my neighbors goes out with a lawnmower, a weed whacker, and a trimmer, gasoline powered, and each one of my neighbors burns a gallon of gas doing that on a Saturday morning, just my development on that hillside puts 14,000 pounds of CO2 in the atmosphere. 1 hour on a Saturday morning lawn care, just that little patch on the hillside.
And Richard, I heard you say that in terms of where we are at now, that we have enough fossil fuel in storage already taken out of the ground?
Well, it's not taken out of the ground, but it's inventory, which means that the fossil industry is already has the permits to take it out.
I see.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But there's five times more CO2 or carbon to be burnt that's already permitted to be burnt, that is five times more than what it would take to put us over that 2 degree Celsius limit that the scientists are saying we can't surpass. Mm-hmm. And so drill, baby, drill is the wrong energy policy. We have got to leave carbon in the ground or we're not going to be here, you know. Basically, that's why I came up with that meme, because we can't do it. We have to find another source of energy, and
John,
we have it.
John, one last word.
Yeah, you were asking about the theological, moral, ethical piece, and I was just thinking of a short line from St. Augustine, who's back in the 2nd and 3rd century, you know, already, who said that paradise is hidden within creation, like seeds waiting for the light of justice and mercy.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
And for me, that sums up where we need to shift our view, our way of looking at the world, and understanding the sacred quality of this wondrous creation that we've been given.
Friends watching us tonight, if you'd like to see this movie and show it to your own group, the movie is available from bullfrogfilms.com. It's a wonderful movie, and we've just seen a part of it tonight. Again, you have been watching Centering on Peace. My guests, John Ankele and Richard Whiteford, thank you very much. You can see us or be with us, the Brooks Peace Community, on the first Monday of every month. Thank you very much.